Good morning, our online family. How many of you guys know that around Mountain Movers Church, something is always happening?
Yeah.
Something is always happening. There's never a dull moment, and this week was no different. On Monday, our teenagers left to go for 6 days at River Point Christian Camp, and woo! Yeah. Yesterday, they just returned in the afternoon, and we want to see just a glimpse of what it is that they did there at camp. Watch this.
One man, 1,000 people.
Camp 2015!
This year at camp,
just do it!
God, I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart.
My most enjoyable thing about camp was probably the worship and also the services. The services were really great.
I especially love Pastor Mike. I love the kayaking.
Fantastic.
In the paintball.
We're supposed to come into our schools this year like a kamikaze, crazy and just on fire, and try to do everything for God we can.
Do it! Just do it!
My favorite part of camp is whenever I was open to God and I just lifted my hands up and praised God. It was just life-changing.
My favorite part about camp was being able to get a closer connection with God.
My favorite part was the worship.
My favorite part is making friends.
My favorite thing about camp this year was the whole entire evening service in general, the worship to get you going, and then the fantastic message really gets you pumped, and the worship afterward. I have to say the worship afterward just felt so close to God, to the point where I would sleep during the afternoon so I could get closer to the evening service. But you should go next year. No regrets.
And be a light in the world.
On fire. Don't let me burn for you again. Let me return to you again.
Part about camp is the night service and praise and worship.
Praise and worship.
My favorite part about camp was when I got to play football and I beat all the boys, and plus my scholars. My favorite part too.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I made a lot of friends.
My favorite part about camp was
Jesus.
My favorite thing about camp was getting to spend a week in fellowship with everyone.
I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart. To light up my soul.
I learned about worship. And I learned about God.
It was a really good trip.
I like to go kayaking, and I loved the evening worship. That's it. Out. Richie Adams and I approve this message.
Man, we are so proud of our teenagers. They are truly coming back on fire. And I want to just say a huge thank you. All the staff at Mountain Movers Church want to thank all the parents who let your kids go. I know that was tough for some of you, not so hard for some of the rest of us. We're like, take our children with you.
We had some mamas that were in tears on the phone the night before.
They were.
Saying, I don't want to let my babies go to camp. They've never left home. And you know what? We encouraged them. We helped them see the light, right?
Yes.
And their kids had a great time.
We love our kids. My son today, actually, he came back yesterday. He went to help take care of some of our younger staff's kids. And today, our oldest baby turns 13 today.
My baby is a teenager.
We're happy to have him home. But we do want to say thank you to all of those who helped sponsor. I will say this. If it wasn't for people sponsoring kids to go to camp, we could not send all the kids
How many kids do we have that went this year?
Over the duration of the last 3 weeks, between our kids camp, our middle, and our teens, we had close to 100 that went and experienced camps, whether here or there. So thank you. I also want to say thank you. We sent more leaders this week. We sent Sean and Kylie Hunt, which is our video team. Also, Tanner Pearson went as one of our sponsors, our male sponsors. Miss Lacey, who is our Accelerate director, she went this year, which was awesome. And Shelby Main got to go again. Shelby is our camp director.
Shelby is our camp rock star.
She is.
She's it.
She is, like, honestly.
She's the rock star.
She's the face of camp.
She is the face of camp.
Yes. Shelby, can I have your face join me up here?
Stand right between Misty and I, please, for a good photo op.
Yeah. I don't know how many of you guys realize that Mountain Movers operates primarily on volunteer power.
We love this girl. She's amazing.
Can you say volunteer power?
Volunteer power!
That's what operates most churches across the world. Miss Shelby is a volunteer camp director, and you have no idea until you fill her shoes the hours that it takes, the parents you have to beg, the money you have to raise to get all these kids to camp. But what we appreciate so much about Shelby is it's not a job that she's doing for a monetary paycheck. It's her heart. Her heart is to get kids and get teens to camp and get them fired up for Jesus Christ. And that's why Shelby does what she does. And the church wants to just honor her this morning with a thank you and a little gift that's inside for all of her hard work.
Love you, Miss Shelby. You're awesome.
Because all of you campers could not have gone had it not been for Shelby's hard work.
Coordinating the whole thing.
She did a phenomenal job. It's exciting. School is right around the corner, and we are going to go in, and we are going to impact our schools like never before, because the kids and the teens at this church are fired up and fueled up and ready to go.
They're fired up and ready to go. How many champions do we have in the room this morning? Let me hear you. Amen. You are a champion, and I believe that with all of my heart. God has called you, and he has qualified you for greatness. He has called you to run this race. And I'm telling you that you have everything you need. God has given you everything that you need to run the race that he has set before you. But the question I want you to ask yourself this morning is, am I even in the race? Am I even on the right track? Am I running the race that God has set for me? Because he made you a winner. So that question should be out of your mind already. God created you to win. That doesn't mean that you're going to win, because winning is a choice. You are a runner. You are in the race. But are you winning the race? That's the question that we have for you this morning. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 2. It says this: therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. And now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Aren't you thankful for that this morning? We are in a race. God has called you to win. He's called you to finish the race. He's called you to a higher calling. He's called you to receive the crown, the reward, if you will, eternal hope in him. Heaven is my home. How about you? I'm telling you that we have so much to look forward to. We were just talking about this in our leadership meeting this morning before church started. We, as believers in Christ, we have so much to look forward to. There's not a day that goes by that I don't think about heaven as my home. There's not a day that goes by that I'm not encouraged by the hope that I have that is only in Christ Jesus. There's not a day that goes by that I don't look in the mirror and I say, thank you, God, that I am called, that my eternity is sealed and it's secure, and my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you, God. Now, Lord, send as many people with me. Help me to reach as many people in this race of life as I possibly can along the way. Let me take as many to heaven as I possibly can in Jesus' name. That is my prayer each and every day. So how do we do this? How do we run the race? How do we really become the finishers that Christ has called us to be? I'm going to do a quick recap right now, except I want to illustrate it with a story. How many of you guys like a story? Yes! Everybody loves a story, but this story is going to entail some volunteers. Grab a sign, I need you. Thank you for your participation and support of God's Word. Yeah! You guys are awesome. All right, bring it. So what we're doing right now is we're distributing these names that represent, these teens are awesome, man. Just came back from camp. They're fired up. My goodness. They are holding signs today that will represent the heroes of faith that you can read about in chapter 11. When you have a chance, I want you to go back to Hebrews chapter 11 and read up on these awesome heroes. We kind of touched on them a little bit earlier in this series, so we're not going to have time to go back through it today. But nonetheless, I want to kind of paint a word picture for you this morning, and this is going to encourage you. So how many of you guys have ever seen like a 5K, a marathon? How many of you guys have ever ran in a race like that? A competitive race. Raise your hand. Yes? All right. Awesome. We have some runners in the room. So how many of you guys know that in that race, usually there's a crowd of people like on both sides of the road, and you're running and gunning, and they're throwing water at you, and you're, whoosh, it's in your face, and you've got the number on your back, and you're doing your thing, right? So this is our crowd this morning, okay? So check this out. In the beginning of verse 1, it says that we are surrounded by a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith. What does that mean? It means that while we are running, we don't necessarily have people that are cheering us on, but we have their past that is cheering us on. Now follow me, okay? What we're talking about this morning is we're talking about all of these great heroes. We've got Enoch, Isaac, Joseph, Samson, Sarah. The list goes on and on and on and on and on. In fact, we don't have all the people mentioned in chapter 11 because I ran out of foam board, okay? But there's more that we can glean from. And what this passage is saying is we have to look at their lives and we have to look at the faith that they had in their life's circumstances and how they overcame and how they were encouraged and how they pressed through and how they just really continued to never, ever give up, and they ran the race regardless, and they were finishers. They were winners. And so the crowd that is cheering us on, the crowd that we are surrounded by in our lives, is the faith that they lived in their lives. Their faith is cheering us on as we're running this race. Obviously, we can't hear these people crying out your name. Yeah, go, Clayton, you're awesome. Woo! But we can read God's word, right? And we can look at their lives and we can see how God took these imperfect people and just did amazing things through their lives. Now, there are times, you know, that we, unfortunately, we trip and we fall, right? You know, you're following me now. We're running along here in this race. We're running. We're going, and the crowds, you know, they're cheering us on. Okay, I'm good. Kind of shake it off, and you keep on running. Thank you. Keep on running. We have to strip off every weight that slows us down, especially that sin that so easily trips us up. What trips us up? It's the sin. It's the junk. Now, I've got these great illustrations. I'm lacking an illustration this morning. I was going to have an awesome net with weights that I was going to be running with. So because I really stink at illustrations this morning and I'm very short in illustrations, your imagination is going to have to fill in the gap. So this morning while I'm running, I want you just to imagine when you're running this race, you have this net that's been thrown on you by the enemy and it's just covered in weights and you're tripping and you're falling and you're stumbling and you're getting tripped up and it's slowing you down just a little bit, right? But you have to, are you going to be okay? Okay, so you have to pull off these weights. You got to pull off these things that trip you up, that slow you down, that get you all tangled up. And you've got to get rid of those things out of your life if you're going to run the race with speed and with endurance. If you're going to last, if you're going to finish, you have to get rid of those things that are tripping you up. So the question for you in your life this morning is, what are those things that are tripping you up? What are those things that are slowing you down? It could be jealousy. It could be envy. It could be anger. It could be lust. It could be pride. It could be greed. It could be gossip. Whatever it is, you fill in the blank. You know yourself better than I do. And the Holy Spirit knows you better than I do. And I know that He's speaking to you right now. And He's sharing those things in the intimacy and in the quiet place of your heart. He's sharing with you right now those things that are tripping you up and slowing you down from running the race the way God intended. You know what's so amazing out of this scripture is when you go to this next scripture, you see it says, let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. So what does that indicate to us this morning? That God has set a race before us to run. That means that God does have a plan and a course that He wants you to walk out in your life. But many of us get so distracted by the side streets called Broadway. The Bible says that broad is the way that leads to destruction, but narrow is the way, the runway that leads to everlasting life. You're running a race, but where are you running and what street are you running on? You might be saying to yourself, hey, I'm just going to follow the crowd. You know, there's way more people over here going this way. They must be going the right direction. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. So just because the multitudes are doing it doesn't mean that you need to do it. Listen, it can be lonely serving God because it's hard. I'm not going to lie. It is hard to live for God. But you can do it because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. God said you could do it. He made you to do it. You have to choose to do it. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. You're running this race. You might be on the narrow street, and you're looking down these side streets as you're running, these broad ways, and you see these masses of people. And I don't get it, God, man. They're driving a brand new vehicle, living in a huge house. They're smiling. They're happy. Their kids are wearing new clothes. He just got a raise. Man, you're comparing yourself to these people that you don't even like, right? And you're constantly, continually trying to measure up and trying to get better and better and better and better because you think that's what makes you happy. And that's not what's going to make you happy. You have to keep your focus on the path that is ahead of you. You've got their faith. You can look back and you can see how God used these people and how they kept the course. They stayed on course. They ran the race and they finished. And if God did it with them, God can do it with you. Thank you guys so much. You can be seated. Thank you for mixing all my notes up. Appreciate it.
Give our volunteers a hand.
Yes, you guys are awesome. I want you to kind of picture it like this. If you're going to run a long distance race, you better have endurance, right? Or else if you don't have endurance, you probably won't make it very far before you're done, right? I mean, have you guys ever seen, what was it? Kung Fu Panda. Has anybody seen Kung Fu Panda? Anybody in the room? Okay, you remember when he runs all the way to the top of the steps, right? And he is like, he barely makes it because he is a fat panda, right? But he is the dragon warrior, right? And so he gets all the way to the top of the steps and then he's like, I am the dragon warrior, right? He's ready to do business. He's all out of breath. He barely made it. He was not created for longevity. He had no endurance, right? He was totally out of shape. But if we're going to make it, we have to have endurance. We've got to be able to make it. We have to be able to condition ourselves. And God wants to use us. I have an illustration this morning. I got this out of the fridge. It's Best Choice Sweet Tea. All right, there you go. And I don't know whose it is, but I got it. And this is supposed to kind of mimic like an energy drink of some sort this morning. As we run with endurance, it's like almost you drink the endurance of God. You fill yourself up. You drink it down and you fill yourself with the endurance of God. Where does that come from? Stay close to Jesus. Walk in His Word. Surround yourself with people that are godly people that are running the race. And man, encourage one another and cheer one another on. Run with endurance the race that God has set before you.
That's right. What we just did is we just recapped part 1, 2, and 3. So if you did not, you weren't here for any of those weeks, you need to go back and get the full in depth. But today we're going to focus, that is the title of today's message, we're going to focus on verse 2, and it says this: we have endurance in this race by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. I want you to look at this first part. It says, keeping our eyes on Jesus. Other versions will say, fix your eyes. That passage right there, literally in the original language, was made up of two words. And it meant this: away from and to see. I want you to think of it like this. If you're going to fix your eyes on Jesus, you've got to look away from everything else in order to see Jesus. In this world, the enemy has a plan, and that plan is to get you distracted by everything else out here. It's like Brad was talking about. If this is Broadway Street, then what we want to do constantly is we want to compare ourselves to other people. We want to think that other things will make us happy. We want to go out and enjoy all the pleasures of this world for a season. You know, the Bible says sin is fun for a season. For a season. Then there comes a time of consequences for our choices that we have laid out before us. And the Word of God makes it clear, if we're going to finish this race, that we have got to unload the weight of sin that so easily trips us up. Those distractions out there. If you go on and you look at this, he says this. Man, this is so good. It says, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Other versions say the author. Pay attention here. Follow this. Jesus was the author of faith altogether. He is the creator and the author. He's not only the beginning, but the Bible says he's the finisher. Do you remember when Jesus went to the cross? The night before he went to the cross, he's in the garden praying, and he gets down on his knees and he's crying out, and he has so much sweat pouring off his face. Drops of blood begin to pour off his face as he says, God, I don't want to do this. I don't want to go to the cross. I'm about to endure the most pain I've ever even thought about. I'm about to be shamed in front of everyone that I helped create. I don't want to do this. Does that sound like any of us? No, I don't want to do it. But then he said, not my will, God, but your will be done in my life. And he went to the cross. And when he went to the cross and he endured the shame and the pain and the humiliation, at the very end of it all, he takes one final breath and he says these words, it is finished. He began it, he created it, he authored it, and now he has finished it. What has he finished? He's finished the race that he was set on, his destination, his path to bring you and I into a perfect relationship with his Father. You see, when he came to earth, he knew what race he was running. He knew that I had to come to earth and I have to live a perfect, sinless life in order to bring all of humanity back into a relationship with God the Father. If I'm going to be the spotless lamb, I have to live perfectly. The Bible says, and you think, well, he was God, that was simple. No, the Bible says that he was 100% God, but 100% man. That means that he had the same thoughts. He had the same ability to sin that we do. The Bible says that he was tempted in every way, just like we are, but without sin. Why? Because sin separates us from God. He held that perfectness all the way to the cross. Then he said, it is finished. I want you to see this second part. It says this. Because, why did he do it? Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he's seated at the place of honor. Another version says it this way. He, for the joy, obtained the prize that was set before him. Okay, listen. You've heard it said before, at the end of a race, there's a prize, right? You're going to run, you're going to run, you're going to get some little something cheesy down here on earth. You're going to get some prize. When Jesus was running this race, this walk, this destiny that God had laid out for him, we were his focus. We were his prize. You were his prize. I want you to think about this. There's a worship song we sing all the time. I think we sang it last week. He is our portion and we are his prize. He loved us so much. Guys, when he went to the cross, he was thinking about you and he was thinking about me. He was thinking about all the lost humanity who literally had no hope in this life if he didn't lay down his own life. Your face is what he was seeing. And yeah, were you perfect? No. Were you going to make mistakes? Yes. But he kept focused. I know what I came to do. I know what I came to do. I don't know how many of you guys are parents. How many moms out there have literally given birth to a child? But if you have ever given birth to a child, in that moment, let me tell you, you are focused on one thing. Bring this baby into this world. It's my prize. 9 months you go through sickness, and 9 months you go through like all kinds of junk that happens in your physical body, and then you go into labor and you go into the most pain you've ever had in all of your life, and your focus the whole time is deliver this baby. This is my prize. And then what does the doctor do? I don't know if you've ever been in there or not. Doctor will plop that baby right on your tummy, and bam, it's like, yes, I did it. I won. I finished. I have my prize. That's what Jesus did. Jesus ran this life, and he focused on you being that prize. If I just finish, if I just hang here on this cross and I take the humiliation, if I will allow them to beat me, if I will allow them to mock me and make fun of me, if I will endure the shame, then I will bring them back into our relationship with my Heavenly Father, which is why we created them. We are the prize. And now God has said to each of us, there's a race set before you. I've given you a beautiful gift. It's called free will. I've laid out the plan. And yes, it's narrow. And some people may get in your way, and you're going to have to move them out of the way because they're going to be a distraction in your life. They're going to get in front of you and try to get you off track. They're going to try to get you to go and do what everybody else is doing. But if you'll stay focused on Jesus, if you'll stay focused on Jesus, you'll keep your eyes fixed. You'll not allow anything else to get in your way or to distract you. You'll say, you know what? I'm not even looking down. I'm going to keep on going. I may trip, but I'm going to get back up because I'm focused on Jesus. He was the author. He was my finisher. I'm his prize. I got to finish. I got to make it to the end. So the second thing we have to do, if we're going to stay focused, point number one is we have to stay focused and eliminate or unload the distractions. Point number two, as we're wrapping it up today, is you got to be disciplined. You got to stay disciplined. It is a word that our society does not like because it's not easy. Look at this passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. It says this, "Don't you realize that in a race, everyone runs, but only one gets the prize. So run to win." How many of you guys played sports? Raise your hand. How many of you guys ever played sports with people on your team who didn't care if they won or lost? How many wanted to kill them? All right. If your hand went up, you might be a real athlete. If you did not, you were probably one that somebody wanted to kill.
You just offended half of the crowd.
Here's why.
Including me.
If you're on it, I know, babe. I know.
Man, I know. I'm sorry.
If cool. I was picking people to be on my team, I would have probably.
I would have been the last. I know.
Yeah, I know. It's okay, though. I love you. But here's what we're looking at. If you are playing on a team, you're playing to win. You show up to win. You put forth the effort to win, to finish the game, to win. And in this life, it's no different. Paul said, when we are coming to run, we're coming to win. He said, all athletes, they are disciplined in their training. Listen, disciplined athletes will get up and do what they have to do to stay in shape and to stay fresh in the off season, even when they don't feel like doing it. If you're a runner, you're going to run every single day. Rain, shine, sleet, snow, it doesn't matter. You're going to run. If you're playing baseball, you're going to play baseball every day. Practicing for what? To win. To go out there and give your best and win. God has called us to do the same thing. The difference is we're not playing for some monetary trophy, some little temporary banner that's going to hang, some little ribbon that's going to go around your neck. My kids have tons of them. We're running for life or death, heaven or hell. Eternity is hanging in the balance as we run this life. And if we will allow the enemy to distract us, we'll fall down and we'll stay there and we'll never finish and we'll never inherit the kingdom of God. Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father today because he finished. It takes discipline. Verse 26 says, so I run with purpose in every step. Hear me out. Every day that you wake up and you have breath still in your lungs, you should run with purpose. There should not be a day go by, even on vacation. You should have purpose. Every day that you live, you should live on purpose. Discipline. To say, I know what I'm going to do. I know that in order to finish the race, I'm going to read my word. Every single day. The song we just sang, the more I seek you, the more I find you. The more I find you, the more I love you. I can attest that that is true. Growing up in my life, my mom made me read the word of God. I'm thankful that she did, because the word of God does not return void. But there came a day in my life where she no longer had to make me read her word, read God's word. She no longer had to force me to do that, because I began to fall in love with the word of God. I began to hear the stories about the Old Testament men and women who made it and think, holy cow, God hasn't asked me to do anything close to what he asked some of those guys to do. What am I whining about? And the more you read it every day, the more you begin to notice every time you look in the mirror, you're different. The things you're saying aren't the same that they used to be. The things you think aren't the same that they used to be. The people you used to love hanging out with, you're kind of like, what was I, was I drunk when I was hanging out with you? Like, you're an idiot, you know? Like, I don't want to be around you. There's a narrow path here to run. You begin to get this focus. And you begin to hone in to say, you know what? Nothing's going to get in my way. I'm going to unload the sin. It's not worth carrying the baggage. And I'm going to focus on Jesus Christ, and I'm going to be disciplined that even when I don't want to, I'm going to do the hard things. Even when those decisions are set before me and I'd rather give in and do what's easy, I'm going to do what's hard. I'm going to be disciplined. Every professional athlete that you look up to and you love watching on TV is there because they are people of hardcore discipline. Every believer that you look up to, it's not that their walk is any easier than yours. They have hardcore discipline. You can have an incredible life. God has laid out a destiny and a purpose for each of your lives today. But if you're going to come in line with God's purpose and plan for your life, and you're going to have the favor of God pouring out of you, I'm telling you, it takes hardcore focus and discipline. But you can do it.
Never an accident that any one person ends up in one of these seats or ends up watching online. It's not an accident. There's a reason why you're here. There's a reason why you're hearing this particular word from God. And I pray with all sincerity right now that the Lord would be speaking to your heart. You know, you might be the person that says, Pastor, I'm running this race and I have tripped and I have fallen over and over and over and over and over again, and you're just saying, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I don't believe in myself. I'm not encouraged with hope. I'm so discouraged and so depressed, I don't even know where to begin. I want to tell you, this is the day that the Lord has made. You can rejoice and you can be glad in it. You know what that means? It means to rejoice means to go back. Just take a step back at your life and choose to have the joy that only comes from who Christ is in you because of what he has done. And in that passage of scripture, it also tells you that today is a brand new day. Today is a brand new beginning. The Bible says the old things are passed away and all things become new. Yeah, God wants you to look back on your past. You're going to be running down that track. You're going to be running this race. And there's times when you look back because you have to see what awesome things God has done and the things that he's brought you out of, because that encourages you and that helps to inspire you to keep on running and to not give up. God is faithful. He's not going to let you down. Don't let yourself down. You have an opportunity each and every day to keep running in this race because God made you a winner. But ultimately, at the end of the day, the choice is yours. You decide whether or not you're going to run. You decide whether or not you're going to win. And my question for you today is, do you want to win? Do you want to run this race with everything you've got? Do you want to be the person that God has called you to be? Do you want to run the race that God has set before you? Do you want to run? Because God has called you to win. Man, you can't lose. You can't lose with God. You might be a person this morning saying, Pastor Brad, I'm running, but I'm about to go up this big whopping hill. And I know that I've got it coming. And what's even scarier than that is I don't even have a clue what's on the other side. You know what? Praise God. Because I guess you're in a position to where you have got to trust in God. You have no choice but to trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but acknowledge Him in all of your ways, and He will direct your path. It's His promise to you. He's not going to leave you. He's not going to forsake you. He's not going to let you down. Satan is a liar, and he's the father of all lies. You can win. You can do it this morning. I know you can do it. God knows you can do it. Do you know you can do it? Do you know that you can do it? Are you willing to do what it takes? You might look at other people in this life that are running the race, and they're awesome believers. They love God. God has blessed their life tremendously. And you say to yourself, man, I want to be like them. You can. You can. And my prayer for you is that you would get to a point to where you're running with such endurance. Man, you're hammering it out, man, the strides. You are just cooking. And people are looking at your life and they're saying, man, I want what they've got. I want an awesome, amazing relationship with God. I want the favor of God and His blessings all over my life. I want the joy and the peace and the hope that has filled their lives. Man, I want that. The Bible says that we should drive people to jealousy for Christ's sake. They would be jealous of what we have in Christ. That's the only kind of good, acceptable jealousy that there is. That we would drive the lost to jealousy. My prayer in my life is that as I'm running, that the people who are on Broadway running that other race on the broad way leading to destruction, that they would say, whoa, 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 guys, everybody slow down, everybody slow. Hey, 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 multitude, hey, everybody. Like, there's only a few people running on that track over there. Why? What's going on? And they're smiling. There's something different about the race that they're running. What is it? My prayer is that we would draw people off of the broadways, off of those racetracks. And that we would lead them to come. Hey, come on. Man, yeah, I know sin, it's fun for a season. I know you're having a good time. Hey, I know you think you're really enjoying yourself, but be honest, you're miserable. Be honest with yourself. You're miserable, okay? You're miserable. You might have all the money in the world. You might have everything you could have ever wanted, but deep down, you cannot be content. You cannot be happy without Jesus Christ, because He's the definition of happiness. He is happiness. There's none like it. He's the Prince of Peace, Lord of Lords and King of Kings. I want to pray for you today. Can I do that? I want to pray for you. I know that the Holy Spirit is nudging your heart today, and He's working on your heart. I see, when I look out in this crowd and I look with my imagination online, I see people who want to run. I see winners. And I want to pray for you right now. Would you stand with me? Father, in Jesus' name, right now, Father God, I see these believers, Lord, who, God, their heart is in it, Lord. They want with everything inside of them, God, to just run that race. God, I pray that You would give them the endurance that they need. I pray that You would encourage them with the faith that was lived by our predecessors in the faith. I pray, God, that they would not get tripped up. I pray they would not get slowed down, God, with the weights of this world. I pray, God, that if they do trip, if they do fall, that they would just get back up. And I pray, God, that they, as they look down the road, that they would put their trust in You, that they would focus and put their eyes on Jesus, the prize. our high calling, heaven, our home. I pray, God, that they would be an inspiration in Jesus' name to those who are watching them run this race, God, that there would be so many people that would want to join them because of who you are inside of them. And God, I pray, Lord, this morning for those who can't see you as their destination, as their destiny, as their finish line. And I pray, God, that as you're working in their heart right now, that they would come to you, that they would admit in their hearts that they have fallen, that they've made mistakes, that they have fallen short of the glory of God, that they have sinned, as we all have, Father God, as we all do. Father, I pray right now, God, that we would believe, that they would believe in their hearts that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died for their sins, and it's only through him they can be saved. I pray that they would confess with their mouths that he is Lord and dedicate from this moment forward that they're going to live for him. What I want to do at this moment with all heads bowed, all eyes closed, for those of you joining us online, I want to know, do you want a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus that is contagious? It is the best decision you will ever make in your entire life. There is nothing on this earth that is comparable to living for God and having heaven as your home and being connected to your destiny in Christ and serving in God's house. There is nothing like it. And I want to give you that opportunity right now. I'm going to count to three. When I do, on three, if you want this real and life-changing relationship that I'm talking about, I want you to raise your hand. If you're at home, I just want you to open your heart. You can raise your hand where you're at and be ready to receive Christ. Are you ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Hands up in Jesus' name. If that's you, I see your hands. I see your hand. Amen. 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 I see your hand. Amen. And we see your hands. They're watching at home or wherever you may be. We see your hands. I want to pray with you right now. Pray this prayer with me. And if the whole house would pray together in honor of those receiving Christ right now, that would be wonderful. Father, we love you. We thank you for Jesus, our Savior, our friend. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you would forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me and make me new again. I believe with all my heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. I confess with my mouth, he is Lord. I dedicate from this moment forward that God, I will live for you according to your word. Help me to be a doer of your word and not a hearer only. Surround me with people that are winning. Surround me with runners. Make God's house my home. Use me. Don't refuse me. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. If you are a winner in God's house this morning, give God a hand clap of praise.
Know that this church is a giving church, right? We give outside the walls of this church to make a difference, not just locally, but globally. This church, I'm telling you, is making a huge, huge difference. Impact on the nations. You wouldn't believe it. You don't judge a book by its cover. I'm telling you, we're making a difference. If you want to give by cash or check, you may do so as the buckets come your way after we pray. If you would prefer to just go the more convenient route, then I would text your giving today, and that's very, very easy. You can just text the number 918-223-8090 and follow the instructions, and you can give digitally.